Hallelujah. I mean, he's happy for that this morning. Well, if you're a free man, you're a happy man. Amen. Who God has set free, the truth has set free, is free indeed. Amen. Amen. We don't have any written prayer requests here before us, but we know there are a lot of needs around the world. Different hearts are suffering with various situations and sicknesses in their body. We just know the Lord has the answer for it all. So we want to remember the bride around the world and the needs there. I do know we have a praise report. Amen. The brother that Brother Tim has been testifying in South Africa, whose wife was healed with cancer. I believe it was his brother got the COVID and was in ICU. And the man drove 400 miles to go give him a prayer cloth and pray the prayer of faith over him. And the man's now out of the ICU and he's on his way back to recovery. Amen. We thank the Lord for that. I believe it's an act of faith that, you know, and believing that God will heal. When you'll just drop everything you got to do and even if you got to go 400 miles or as Brother Ron came 17 hours, whatever it takes to get to Jesus, it's worth it. And I hope you came this morning to get to Jesus. Amen. Not to get to a church or to a service or you know, just a gathering, but to get to Him. That's what we came for. And so I asked Brother Joe if he'd come and open our service in prayer this morning. Let's just pray together. Amen. As believers, I know there's a lot around the world that's suffering with this COVID and then also cancer and things. So let's just remember the body of Christ today.
Amen. You're glad to be here this morning. You got a need this morning. You want to lift it before the Lord. He understands. He knows. Father, we bow before your throne of grace this morning. What a great privilege we have as individuals. Lord, whose hearts have been turned, whose lives have been changed, Lord, by the revealed word of this hour. Lord, we don't take it for granted that you've called us and placed us here. Lord, we know that everything that you've done, you have a purpose behind it. And Lord, we're here today to acknowledge that purpose. Lord, and to come to bring our adoration and our praise to you, Lord. We're no longer living in a life of sin and unbelief, but Lord, our lives are straight on the word of God. And Father, how it feels to be a son and a child of God in this hour, Lord, when chaos surrounds us. Lord, we know that, Lord, you said you prepare a table in the presence of our enemies, Lord. And we're so thankful today that we're able to eat at that table this morning, Lord. When all chaos is going on around us, Lord, we're seated there, Lord, Father, feeding on the word of this hour. We're so thankful, Lord, that you've provided a feast for the bride of Christ. And Lord, we just come this morning to present our needs to you, Lord, knowing that there's only one that can meet that need this morning. Father, you saw the hands that was lifted. You saw the hearts that were represented, Father, by that hand. And I'm asking today, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would begin to go to that heart. Lord, go to that need this morning and be able to bring the answer that they desire. Lord, you see the praise report of our brother there in South Africa. Father, we believe that faith is works is faith expressed, Father. And Lord, that's what we have need of this morning, is to let our faith loose, Lord, to bring the right results, Father, to trust you, Lord, even when we can't see it, when we can't feel it, Lord, when we don't understand it, God. We're going to believe your word no matter what, because we believe, Father God, that the word is made nigh unto the children of God. And Lord, you said, whatsoever things that we have need of this morning, if we will pray, God, and we will ask you, Father, and Lord, and not doubt in our heart, then we can have whatsoever things we desire. Lord, we're praying deliverance from cancer. We're praying deliverance from COVID-19. We're praying deliverance from high blood pressure, from brain bleeds, Lord, from a dead wound. God, we believe this morning because we're taking God at his word. Lord, you said ask, we're here asking. Lord, you said knock, we're here knocking. Lord, you said believe, we're here believing. You said trust me, we're here trusting you this morning, God. Lord, I pray that faith to rise in the bride of Christ this morning. I pray that the word of God will come and Lord, begin to move them into a higher realm of faith, Lord, and a higher realm of belief this morning. Lord, we put all our unbelief aside. Lord, we put all our doubts aside, God, and believe the revealed word is here. Lord, the seals have been opened. The book has been loosed this morning. It's been handed down to the bride, Father, and we're believing, Lord, that in a moment we're going to be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. God, may our faith rise up today, God. May we not be held by circumstances and held by indifferences and held by political views, but God, may we be held by the word of God. May we be anointed by the Holy Ghost this morning, Lord, to rise up and claim the promises of God. God, we commit this service now to you, Lord. We pray you pour out your spirit. We pray you pour out your anointing. Lord, we pray you'll open up the windows of heaven, God, and rain down a blessing upon every need, every heart, every child, young or old, Lord. No matter what it may be, God, may you move this morning, Father. Grant it today, Father God. We commit this time to you now. May this not just be a time of gathering, Lord, but may be a time where the bride comes, Lord, to receive strength for the journey, to receive, Lord, the word that she has need of. So we commit it to you this morning, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, and in Jesus' name we believe. Amen and amen.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that'll be. I just want to thank the Lord also, my wife and two daughters in the car wreck yesterday, but all we lost was the car. Everybody else is okay. Amen. That's praise the Lord for that. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Why don't you just turn around, wave at your neighbor, greet each other in the name of the Lord. Oh, sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace in the mansions, bright and blessed. See Jesus will sing and shout the victory. Oh, while we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will over spread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. We'll sing and shout victory.
There are some things I may not know, and there are some places I cannot go. Oh, but I am sure of this one thing.
Victory this morning. I believe every one of us can testify to that. We know we serve a real, true, and living God.
Well, victory is mine. Oh, victory is mine. Victory today is mine. Will I told Satan to get thee is mine. Well, Satan came this morning without even a warning. Said, why don't you just quit or compromise? I said, listen here, you devil. With you, I'm gonna level. I can't quit, my eyes are on the prize. For I made my decision, and my eyes have caught the vision of my heavenly bridegroom in the sky. So Satan, get behind me, for one day you won't find me, for the victory is already mine. Oh, victory is mine. Oh, victory is mine. Victory today is mine. Well, I told Satan, is mine. Sing that second verse again. Satan came this morning without even a warning. Said, why don't you just quit or compromise? I said, listen here, you devil. With you, I'm gonna level. I can't quit, my eyes are on the prize. For I made my decision, and my eyes have caught the vision of my
wonderful to, you know, you go a lot of places and to have a church where you can just call somebody up that like that, that caliber to lead some songs. Wow, I love it. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Oh, draw me, Lord. I think it's in D. Praise the Lord. Let's just be drawn into His presence this morning in Jesus' name. Oh, draw me. Draw me, Lord. Oh, draw me, Lord. And I'll run. Oh, draw me. Oh, draw. Lord, I
We love.
And every kind of thing, but we exalt the true living God, a God who's the same yesterday, today, and forever, a God who's God and don't change. How we love you, Father. How we praise you, Lord. Let there be a sacrifice of praise come from our lips this morning to thank you for your keeping power, to thank you for your saving grace, to thank you, Lord, that you didn't leave us where you found us, but you lifted us up and you set our feet upon a rock, Lord. God, what a blessed people we are today. What a blessed people we are. Every one of us this morning could say we're blessed. We're blessed to know you, Lord, that you know us, Father, that you called us by name, that you brought us, Lord, to this place this morning to receive something from you. We're blessed people this morning. God, that you prepared a man to preach a message this morning to speak to our hearts. God, we're blessed people. God, we thank you, Father. We glorify your name. We praise you, Lord, for you're truly worthy of all praise and all glory and all honor. Amen. Let's stand together this morning as we get ready for the word. Key of C, Elilah, Elohim. Hallelujah. Elilah, Elohim.
Hail, just bow our heads together. Jesus, where you're in your presence today, we want to welcome you, Lord. We want your presence among us. We want you to speak to our hearts. Reveal yourself to our lives. You're God that heals every disease, even down to sin sickness. Lord, you know how to deal with hearts and lives. And we're asking that you would do it, Lord. There are those here in the presence today that they got desperate needs. There's needs in their marriage, in their home. Lord, a lost loved one that is there floundering out in sin, and they're desperate for deliverance. Men and women write me from all over the world. Pray for my wife. Pray for my children. Pray for my son-in-law. Pray for this. Pray for this sickness. Lord, your bride around the world needs a touch from you. We're just asking God that you provide that touch. You're a miracle-working God. Lord, we believe that right now, this month is a month of miracles. Lord, we've been through the trials of 2020. We're in order to see miracles, and now we're seeing miracles. Lord, today we're looking for miracles. We're speaking miracles. We're professing that you're the God of miracles. That you can reach further down than what we can look up. You can reach right down to the gutter of where men and women are and find them, the lost, and bring them in. That the prodigals will return home. That the spirits that have them bound will be loose from them today. Lord, oh God, and for your people, many of them sick, even ministers, pastors, evangelists, beloved evangelists, have sickness in their home with this COVID. Lord, it's a virus, an unseen virus, but there's an unseen hand. An unseen hand reaching out, doing miracles this day. Raising them up, lifting them up, causing their faith to rise to the level of the promise. And I'm asking God for that deliverance. Lord, months ago I was there in a bedroom, asleep, woke up in the middle of the night, hearing the songs that we shall see miracles. We shall see giants fall. Hallelujah. We believe, Lord. Therefore, we speak. And we profess, Lord, you're the miracle-working God. And though it seems impossible to man, it's not impossible to our God and to those that believe. I pray as we read the Word of God together today that you'll inspire our hearts to believe. Lord, open our hearts to receive of you. We give ourselves to you in this service today. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. And the church said, amen. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Let's just give him praise right now. Amen. That's right. Give him thanks. Give him praise. He's the Almighty God. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here today, and thank you for the wonderful worship of the Lord that we have had together. We're going to turn to Joel chapter 2, verse 25 for our scripture reading this morning. It is a prophecy of the last day, that where we are fulfilling what's happened in the pouring out of the Spirit in the upper room. And now we see God pouring out the remainder, the last of his Spirit here in this last day as he finalizes the work. And the last few receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Aren't you glad to be one of those last few? Yes. Amen. So he says, and I will restore to you the years that the locust has eaten, the cankerworm, the caterpillar, the palmer worm, my great army which has sent among you. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God that had dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. And ye shall know that I'm in the midst of Israel and that I am the Lord your God and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And upon those servants and upon those handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit. Amen. God bless you today. You can be seated. Greetings to all of you around the world as those are tuning in from South Africa and different other places. And we'll be listening to this in Australia, New Zealand, different other places. They don't need to hear me. They just need to hear Jesus. Amen. Amen. We're just one of the many that God has called and ordained in this day. We have no special place in the body other than just as a minister of the gospel. And so you don't need to even need to know my name to go into rapture. You just need to know Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Nice to see you, Sister Margaret, today. God bless you. Welcome today. Amen. Been a while since you've been here, and each one of you that are here with us today, we just welcome you. There's the Arbor guest back there. God bless you. Nice to have, and a new baby. Amen. Let's welcome them today. Amen. We appreciate that. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's wonderful. We appreciate that family very much, and we thank them for being with us today. We're going to look into the Word today, as I had promised to do last week, and do part two of Is There Hope of Revival? And we dealt with what the Pentecostals are looking for, and last week, and that revival, and the ending of that divine healing revival, and we showed how that we're not looking for another divine healing meeting like that. Brother Branham said it never was God's will for all of that. He said it should have been in every church and every service, laying hands on the sick and they shall recover. But God had to do that to get our faith back in the promise. And so we find in the message, Brother Branham preached a sermon called Trying to Do God a Service Without His Will. And many are calling for revival, and they're calling for America to be revived. And we dealt with that. They cannot be revived because they have crossed the line between judgment and mercy. And so, we of course are looking to the promise. What is there in there for us, the bride of Jesus Christ? Amen. And Brother Branham spoke on this, trying to do God a service in Shreveport in 1965. And one of his last sermons that he would preach before he departed. And he said, God is sovereign, you know, and we find this is true. God is so sovereign that he's sovereign in the way that he does things. Nobody can tell him what to do. You can't make him do anything. You can't really call God down and make him do something. God does things on his own. And when he does, he puts things in the hearts of men to begin to call upon God to do things. He said that God is sovereign, you know, that people are wondering why we can't have a revival, but God is sovereign. And they have tried for the last 120 years just to revive Azusa Street and have not been able to do so. But he said, I was discussing with a group of my fine brothers, they were Baptist brothers, and said, they told him, said, Brother Branham, we can only have a revival if we would take word by word by word and page by page and by letter. And he says, I believe too, page by page. They've been trying to do that all along. But they said, but we must have the perfect Greek interpretation of the word, what Greek has says, so that we can have a revival. And it will take, getting the word, every word translated with a perfect meaning. And he said, well, I hadn't read too much, but reading the history of the church, Nicene Council and the pre-Nicene Council and Nicene Fathers, they were arguing back there about the Greek. He said, that was 2,000 years ago. And one would say it means this, and the other says, well, it means that, and said, just like our language, you can have different a word, and it will have maybe the same sound, but it will have a different meaning depending on how it is being used. And he said, God wrote it like that, and he said, all of this trying to interpret it and getting everything just perfect, he said, all the Word of God is inspired. And he said, Jesus said, I thank thee, Father, because you have hid these from the eyes of the wise and the prudent, but you reveal it unto babes, such will learn. It's a revelation of him. And so they said, to do this, he said, it won't work. To get this a new interpretation, as you know, there's probably, well, I don't know how many interpretations today of the Greek. I've got a Bible that contains 40 of them, the different Greek interpretation. But he said a revival will never come until God, the sovereign God, sends it. And then he might take up a little nitwit that can't even sign his name and do it with it. He said, that don't even know good English, let alone the Greek. And he said that's what he did when Peter preached at Pentecost. This man couldn't sign his name. He was ignorant and unlearned. Amen. But he said God does things that are so strange to our intellectual thinking. But, the different ones, they all thought they had it just right. But God went down and got fishermen and bypassed the Caiaphas is the high priest and the learned man and the scribes and the Pharisees, and took a little ignorant fisherman that couldn't even sign his own name. And so he takes something that out of nothing to do something for his glory. Because he's the God who would take a world that was in chaos and make an Eden out of it. And then Brother Branham shared his views of this, and he said, he said, if anybody's got the mechanics for revival, it's our brother, noble brother Billy Graham. But he said, mechanics is all right, but the mechanics won't move it. It takes the dynamics to move it. And he went on to explain to these brothers that you can take and build an automobile, put fine seats in it, and have fine pistons, and prove by science what it can do. But unless the dynamics is there, she's just a dead piece of goods. And so, he said, there again that people are getting, he said, but and trying to work up great things and got the mechanics for it and the system, the education, the religious system, the seminaries, everything in place to try to bring a revival. And he said, but you let God in his sovereign grace just speak to some little nitwit, a little nobody, and let his spirit fall into a city when man can't go to work and women can't wash dishes and the maid can't make the bed, a screaming and crying with their hands up in the air. He said, that's revival in the will of God. Amen. See, it's not something that is drummed up and made up and worked up. It is something that is sovereign. And he said, again, he gave the testimony of the Welsh revival when some fine, dignified men came from America and went to Wales there to find out what was, how was this revival? How was it made? How can we duplicate this? And so they went looking for the Welsh revival, and they saw a policeman there on the side of the street, and he was directing traffic and said, sir, can you direct me to the Welsh revival? And he said, you're right here, I'm it. You see, revival is not in a building. It's not in a certain group. Revival has to come in sons and daughters of God. And so it's sovereign when God, that's what God does. He has he alone has the right to send a revival. And not get the mechanics together, but begin to pray for the dynamics. But so many of the message communities are void of the dynamics today. All they got is a Billy Graham type of mechanics. Even the conversions that is offered is a Billy Graham type of conversion of easy believism. Billy Graham, you know, just come up and receive Jesus as the Lord of your life and confess I'm a sinner and accept him as your Savior. And what did he find after they made their profession of faith? He himself said, I'll have 30,000 converts and I'll come back a year later and I can't find 10 of them. And of course, he blamed it on lazy preachers who he would give the invitation cards to that they signed, I've received the Lord, and they didn't go and follow up and make a visitation. And he blamed it on lazy preachers and rebuked the preachers. And Brother Branham said, that's not the problem, Billy, you're missing it. He said, the real problem was you didn't take them far enough. You got them to make a confession of faith, but you didn't take them far enough. And today it's not come up and accept Jesus, but just sit in your seat and accept the message. And Brother Branham is the prophet. And I'll tell you, that's pure blasphemy to call that the new birth. Amen. No wonder we got a bunch of rotten eggs in the nest today. They have never been with the male bird. Amen. They've never received the life from Christ. Now, of course, Brother Branham told us this himself in the message, Perseverance. He said that's the way that people does about coming to Christ. They lay the foundation. I want you to listen carefully. They lay the foundation of believing on the Lord Jesus and accepting him as personal Savior and maybe going on to Christian baptism. But when it comes to following on through to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, somebody explains it away from them, and that's the reason they are the seed fell by the wayside or fell on stony grounds, or let me add, you know, fell among thorns. Whirling has come and choked them out, and they lost the victory that they did have. And of course, this brings us now to the cycle of revival and death that we are experiencing in the world today. And this is, would begin with Revelation 2 and 4 that says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. And now, to understand this, you got to realize that the Spirit was not just talking to Ephesus alone. But rather that history keeps repeating itself. And so it's just the same thing would happen with Israel. We would see a revival in one generation, only see the fires fading in the next. You can see them, again, in those cycles that God would send, a prophet, or he would send a judge in the book of Judges, and there would be a revival and a turning back to God, and then they would as that kind of grew old and the judge would go off the scene, well then the next generation was less fervent and less ardent about the truth, and they began to let down the bars, as it was. And the next thing you know, that generation would die, and they would go back into idolatry again. And God would send another judge or another prophet, or in the king's cases, a righteous king. And there would be a revival and restoration of the word. And Ezra would get up and read the word again. And the people would stand, dedicate their hearts to God, only to fall away again. Until they would finally be carried away in the Babylon. Now, so this is the way that we see it. Revival in one generation, only see the fires fading in the next. In the third generation, maybe an ember glowing a little bit. In the fourth, there's no vestige of that power and that original glory even found. All you have to do is look at some of the moves that we have today. John Wesley's move, great move of God. Only to see them go into such disgrace until now they're just an LGBT movement. Now, isn't that right? Amen. You were there, wasn't you? Yes, sir. You know what they had in their pulpit and what they were advocating. Amen. And nobody would do a thing about it, would they, Brother L? Stand up, Brother L. Give testimony to that right now. You walked out of there. Amen. You know why? Because the man heard a voice that said, come out of her, my people, that you not be partakers of her plagues. Hallelujah. Amen. Then, you know, again, then of course it would go down and God would light the flame again. And, you know, it's a manifestation of this truth. God doesn't have any grandchildren. Amen. And salvation cannot be passed on by natural birth at all, because it's impossible. And people get born into a church and you know, after a while, well, I don't know if I believe it like they do. And they begin to compromise a little bit and become real liberal in their beliefs. Yeah, we got a bunch of Demorats sitting on message pews. Amen. Amen. Somebody didn't hear that, did they? Amen. That's exactly what I meant. A bunch of liberals who aren't unable to judge between right and wrong. And let me just tell you, while I'm there, Republicans can't either. They're as backslidden as the rest of them. Amen. But again, it shows us salvation is not passed on by natural birth. Every person must have their own revival. Every generation must have their own revival. Every person must have their own chance at the word. And that's what we got to keep offering in our churches is their chance, your chance, to have your own revival. Till you can be like the policeman standing on the street and saying, I am that revival. Amen. That revival is in me. I am a living representation of that power of God that changed my life and made me a new creature in Christ. Not just take on a denominational name that we now call message. And many of them are just as locked up as tight as denominations are. And they are part of the group that have been indicted in this generation because they crucify the effects of the word. Amen. You know, I realize a lot of things I'm going to say today that a lot of guys maybe couldn't get by with. But I've had 50 years of preaching this message. I'm not talking as a novice. I've been there. I've watched it. I've seen it, where the people were the fervent desire to please God, that passion to know his word. Oh God, I know with me, you know, when I was a boy, shoved my books in the locker, got my spoken word books, had me a 2-hour study hall. Maybe you can't do that and get you a PhD, but I'll tell you what, I hadn't needed one yet. Amen. Maybe you don't call that very smart, and I'm not condoning the ignorance. I think you boys need to get an education, be able to be able to support your family, especially in a day when we tell our sisters they really ought to be homemakers and stay at home and raise children. That's still the message. Career girl in this church, that's still the message. And those of you pursuing a career, you're as backslidden can be, and you lost the real vision of why you are here. Well, that's going to cut your ties in half, Brother Tim. If it ain't never been my ties, it's God's ties, and he's got the cattle on 1,000 hills. He's always provided. I'd rather see mothers at home and raising their children to serve God than to see them out here with some of these godless babysitters. You girls ought to have an ambition. I'm going to be a mother. I'm going to be a Christian. I'm going to raise my children to serve God. That's my ambition. But it's pounded in you in this liberal modern society. I'm a feminist. And this moves right into the message. No, I didn't plan on preaching this, but it's okay. It's still the message. And you men ought to have a goal. I'm going to make it where my wife can raise my children and nurture them. And you young men ought to have a goal. Okay. You forgot your rotten tomatoes and eggs. And it's a good thing. Because I got a few more things to say today. That fervent desire to please God, that passion to know His Word, the cry for reaching out in the Spirit begins to fade. And instead of that church being on fire with the fire, God has cooled off and become formal. And of course, this is what happened, that abandonment to God, that hunger to know His Word. You know, to get into the message, oh, you see, that's so archaic and so out of step. Thank God is out of step. It's the only sane thing left. Everything else are voices of insanity. The people change their matter of dress, their attitudes, their behavior. They get lax. Why? Because the cycle of revival and death has never failed. We look back at the last move, the Pentecostal move, where men and women were dressed like Christians. They went to church. They prayed all night. They stood on the street corners. They weren't ashamed of the manifestations of the Spirit. Amen. Amen. They left their old dead churches and worshiped in homes or old store buildings. I think sometimes we need another revival like that. Amen. Where we leave some of these old dead churches. Amen. And we're not ashamed of the manifestation of the Spirit. Amen. But somebody that's got reality. And soon the freedom of the Spirit was gone. Oh, they kept on with the form. Because the Bible said they would have a form of godliness, but they would deny the power thereof. Now, so again, the power to do what? The power to live an overcoming Christian life. Now, But again, Brother Branham preached a sermon called How Can I Overcome? And in there, he was talking about how to overcome against this Laodicean spirit. And he says that, but he said, I chose this text because we should never let that spirit of revival die. We got to keep in revival constantly. Revived every day. Amen. Stay in the Spirit. Stay in the Word. Hear the voice of God. Amen. Come on with me. He told an experience of crossing an old log. And he stepped out on it, was across the creek. And he stepped out on a big chunk, fell off. And he must have almost fell into the water. And he said it looked good on the outside, but inside it was just doughy and rotten. He said it, and he said, that's the way Christians are becoming. And this is what caused him to preach this sermon. He looked at that log that was laying in the water, and he said, as he stepped back and looked at it, he said, that's the way Christians are coming. Now listen, he wasn't preaching this to the Pentecostals. He was preaching this to his own church. Amen. And he said, they've been dead in sin and trespasses so long till they become doughty. They can hold no weight at all. They don't know what overcoming means. So he said, that's when I began to think of this text. And he said, there you go. You take a Christian that's supposed to be a Christian and you let the life of God go from him. And the experience and the joy of serving Christ. And living in a church where such is going on, and he rottens twice as quick. Oh my. Now, so again, we look at that, and we begin to realize, oh God, keep me true in this hour. Keep me fervent. Don't let me be lukewarm. Now, so in this, he even describes this. I'm going to read this instead of paraphrasing it. He said, I was talking to someone the other day and said, and he made this observation, they're very careful, even many of the holiness group, not to call the Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, because they identify themselves with Pentecostals when they do that. They say Holy Spirit to keep from saying Holy Ghost, because the Pentecostal common people just call it what the Bible says, Holy Ghost, which Holy Spirit and Holy Ghost is the same thing, but they're very careful about it. Listen, they don't want to be identified with them tongue-speaking people, and that's the Holy Spirit itself. Now, friends, bring it right on down to our generation, down to 2020. As Brother Branham would preach in Ashamed of Him, he said they blushed to say, I speak with tongues. Yes, I believe in visions. Now, and he said, what happened with these kind of people like this? He said, when the enemy went out under sanctification and go back to conversion, you get baptized, you believe, you make a profession, you get baptized, and whatever. When the enemy went out under sanctification and they were washed out, then that spirit come back and found that house empty and not filled with the Holy Ghost. And the state of the church becomes seven times worse than itself, than it was. Amen? And so there again, you can look and you can almost look at every move that there's been. When they refuse to go on with God, when they lost their revival, they become seven times worse. Until God identifies them with their mother whore and calls them a harlot. And the judgment is on them as well as is with Mother Whore, the first denomination, the Roman Catholic Church. Now, the second reason that people, that revival dies, another reason for no revival is because we're predestinated. And we're secure, and the rest can go to hell if they want to. And there comes no burden for the lost. And there comes no outreach into the spirit and no travail of soul for those that are lost. No concern. And Brother Branham told us this in the fifth seal. He said when John Wesley came along after Zwingli had come and Calvin, and he got to church, and Calvin got to church to a place on security, they didn't want more revivals because whatever's going to be is going to be. That was all. And they just lived any kind of life. So again, we can come to the point in our minds where we hear we're the predestinated bride. We are predestinated to be there until the point that we just become lax. Well, we're going to make it. The Word said we're going to make it. We're predestinated. Well, I'll tell you what, if you are predestinated, if that is your destiny, there's going to be a fire and a drive in your life pushing you to that destiny. Not some laziness after God. Not some formalism. Amen. Not some lack of prayer and consecration. But a people who know their God. And those that know their God really know that God do exploits. The third reason revival dies is because God in every age sends a messenger. And we're in the last age. This is the last message. And that message there, light comes to him, to the messenger. And then from that messenger, there spreads the light to the ministry of others who have been faithfully taught. Amen. But those who, of course, who go out don't always learn how necessary it is to speak only what the messenger said. Remember, Paul said, warned the people, say only what he said. 1 Corinthians 14:37. If any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. What came the word of God out of you, or came it to you only? He said, they add here or they take away there, and soon the message is no longer pure, and the revival dies down. How does the revival die down? By adding to. You know, we got to embellish the message a little more. We got to make it something that it isn't. We got to add our own little thoughts and twists to it, and where the ministry gets puffed up. Amen. A little revelation comes to him, maybe an inspiration. Oh, brother, glory to God. You know, do that again. And he goes and he tries to do it again. And the next time, it's not the inspiration. It's his own ideas. And, oh, he brings this great sermon up. You know, we get to the point where it becomes in the message, the seals, the thunders, the seals, and the seventh seal is this, and the seventh seal is that, and the seventh seal is that, and we go on and on, and we forget. That's not the way Brother Branham preached the message. He preached on the seven seals, and he come back and preached, the world is falling apart, and God in simplicity. Amen. The flashing red lights are the sign of his coming. And warning, then judgment. And all kinds of different messages there. Is your life, not your wife, is your life worthy of the gospel? Amen. He began to, he would go and preach on these different things. And then he would come back with Christ, the mystery of God revealed. Amen. The seven trumpets, the feast of the trumpets, or some of these other great things that God would expand. But then he would come right back down and begin to preach on things that dealt with your everyday Christian walk. Because I don't care how much you're here in your knowledge, if it don't come down to a Christian walk, it's worthless. Amen. First thing you know, a man would say, well, I can read between the lines. Well, you can't read between the lines of Brother Branham's message. The message was taking the Bible and the stories of the Bible and reading between the lines. We already got what's between the lines, and it matched what was on the line. But you know, we then revival dies down. First thing that you think you know, they don't want the Holy Ghost moving in the songs. They don't want the Holy Ghost moving in the pew. All they want is some dignified intellectual preacher that can never bring a revival, because he don't have a revival. He's got knowledge and intellectualism instead of the Word of God, and it don't produce a life. Brother Branham tells us that every fresh and true revival, because men got back to the Word in their age. And he said every age was a cry of rebuke. You left the Word of God, repent and come back to the Word. And I say, we need a repentance. Across the world, we need a repentance and a coming back to the Word. Then you wouldn't have these stupid ideas that Christ has left the mercy seat. Amen. Then you wouldn't have this blasphemy that is going on. That man is already saying, well, you know, we're already in the rapture, and to the point they do away with the literal return of Jesus Christ. Brother Branham said, in world falling apart, our great fine training of ministers has taken place of all night prayer meetings. So we've trained preachers. And the old time way back to God, we used to get to God. Instead of having preachers, we got lecturers. men who know the word just as well. They can sit there and put together in such a way that it's astounding how they can do it. They know the mechanics, but it ain't the dynamics. We want the dynamics. I don't care about the mechanics. I want to know the dynamics. What does it do? Amen. He said, I don't know how that car runs. It's got pistons and cylinders, and I don't know as much pressure, how much pressure it used. The only thing I know is the dynamics. Put her out there and drive it. That's what we know. God made a promise. I'll pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. How's he going to do it? I can't tell you. I just want to know the dynamics of God's system. That's the main thing. You know, when Brother Branham left here, he left us a car that would drive. It would run. He left it running. Amen. As I've said, it would drive down to healing. It would drive down to miracles. It would drive to the real power of the Holy Ghost. It would drive down to the, it would take you to the baptism of the Holy Ghost. It went somewhere. Amen. To a holy life, to godly men and women. Brother Branham talked about seeing a train. He said, had this Zephyr engine. I don't know anything about it, but, you know, it looked so pretty. He went to the dining room, and the Pullman showed him all the different, to the Pullman, and it was showed by the conductor all the prettiest things, the bells and whistles on this beautiful train. He said, about like churches today, big spires and PhD and LL. Oh no. They ain't educated, maybe, but, you know, in school and learning like that, but they've educated themselves into the message, where it's just a knowledge instead of a life. And he said, standing behind the pulpit, fine robe on, curly hair, bow and said, oh, man, the prettiest. He said, brothers, I'm sick of this Hollywood evangelism. But he said, as he looked at that train, he went through it, and he said, well, when's it going to move? Can it move? He said, no, sir. Well, he said, I'd like to take a little ride. He said, it can't move. I said, why? He said, there's no fire in the engine. And he said, that's what's the matter with the church. It's plushed up and decorated up with no fire in the engine, and you can only move by the fire. Amen. So what we need today is the Holy Ghost and fire. Amen. Now, the message that the prophet left us had fire in it. Amen. It had power in it. Had deliverance in it. Had the Holy Ghost in it. Amen. But that's what's happened. So many have accepted the tradition of easy believism, the message of Billy Graham, and instead of the message to Abraham, and that will send you to the tribulation just like it did to Lot. And there are many message churches preaching their people into a tribulation because they're not getting the token. Now, again, Brother Branham said, you know, about that, he said, you know, again, he would go through it, and he says, you know, he said, what good is this automobile in it? What good is the lights or fixture if there's no current to go in it? We got the mechanics, schools, and educators to can train man, stand the pulpit with such manners till he's an eloquent person. And that still don't bring the power of God. Where is the power of God that used to be in the church? Where is that Pentecostal blessing that used to flow through the churches? Now, I'm just going to give you a cue. There'll be just one or two, maybe, in my whole sermon that I'll refer to before 63. These are all after the seals, in case you want to disqualify this. You know, great, forgive me for a moment. And pardon me, you know, if I step on someone's toes. But we've had great intellectual teachers, like Brother Lee Vail. And where did that take us? You know, look at the folly, the powerless group of people. Look where that group ended up. I stand there. I've watched them for years. You know, where did that group end up? You know where that group ended up? We don't have no power. We have no miracles. We have no signs. We have no wonders. So they went back to return ministry and said, oh, it'll never happen until Brother Branham rises from the dead, and then we'll have the power again. Nothing's going to happen until Brother Branham comes back. Let me just correct that for you. There ain't nothing going to happen until Jesus comes back in the church, in the midst, and in the ministry, and people quit putting him out of their churches like a bunch of Laodiceans who have closed the door on the Holy Ghost and the power of God. While I'm cleaning the house, the other side, the Coleman Thunder group, all screaming and hollering and claiming that to be the bride's revival. Calling themselves the Headstone Ministry. People all jumping up and down and shouting. And you know, one group of them, you know, crying out to their preacher, calling him Elohim, Elohim. And another saying that their preacher is the Holy Ghost. And you know, what nonsense. It's idolatry. Amen. And then, you know, jumping up and screaming and calling that the bride's revival, which is nothing but a bunch of man-made emotional workup. I'm not going to preach for this. Don't turn it on. But this is the way they do. They'll make their point and then they'll hold it out to you. You scream. You're supposed to scream. You're supposed to holler. You're supposed to stand up. You're supposed to. And they work up a crowd. And you're no different from these Pentecostals that blow in their microphone and people fall over everywhere. You get people to jump up and down. You can train them to them. That is a form of worship where the power is denied that really changes lives. Amen. And once more, he said, there's where Satan got in to make it all mechanics. That's one movement, and no dynamics, and then back all dynamics and no mechanics. We got to put the two together. We got to come back to power. We got to have the power of the Holy Spirit, but we got to come back with the word to feed this machine. You see, people make their balance or lose their balance. You clip this wing, and it's... No, you know, it's all word, and this one over here, the emotions is clipped, and you just flop around in a circle. Get over here, and you got all emotions, and the word is clipped. The word. We got to go back to the word to feed this machine. The word, not creeds of two lords. Amen, and the rapture is over, but the word. Not Coleman's thunders. Brother Vail was a teacher who thought he was needed to help Brother Branham say what he could not. You know, he was the Aaron to Moses that didn't have his own message. And so he was the Aaron to Moses. But remember, the Aaron to Moses didn't have his own books that everybody quoted. Were the exalted teacher over the prophet. And it's not a Coleman, a wannabe apostle to bring clarity to the message again to help Brother Branham say what he could not, because Brother Branham never taught the thunders were the virtues. Amen. They too have to have their own books, because what they believe is not found in the message. Amen. They add here, they take away there, and soon the message is no longer pure and the revival dies down. How careful we must be to hear one voice, for the Spirit has but one voice, which is the voice of God. Amen. And we heard the voice of God in this age. Amen. I don't need you to bring clarity. We need to say what the prophet said. Amen. Brother Branham said, you know, this, as he began to cry out about these things and the voice of the sign. He said he heard their cries and their groans and their prayers. They were only waiting for God. God was waiting on them. He had his prophet out there in the wilderness, speaking of Moses, but he was only waiting for his people to call him into action. And I believe he has the same thing today, waiting for his church to call it on the scene so he can act. The promise of today is ready, but he's got to get the people praying and groaning like they were down there, and then it'll come on the scene. When the people, amen, God's got the word ready. But you got to get in a place where, God, I want you more than life. Amen. Where people don't just, oh, yeah, I need the Holy Ghost. You know, I got this pornography. I got this, and I'm grieved here or there. But until, God, if you don't give me the Holy Ghost, amen, I'm going to die right here. Till you become desperate. They called for revival. Brother Branham said, he said, how can you have revival when the word can't work through you? He said, I'd like people to answer that. How can you do it when you deny the very revival itself? Well, did the prophet speak of on forms of godliness? Now, we're living in some serious times. We're living where people are in the spirit of this age, where knowledge has increased, and the spirit of rebellion is upon people. There's more, people are in the spirit of the end time. They really are. But let me tell you, there's a bride who also will be in the spirit of the end time. And when we begin to see God move among us, when we begin to see miracles happen, amen, when we see one like Sister Karen who the doctors didn't give 5 minutes to live or maybe 5 years, but whatever, she would not have any quality of life, and see her in the service today well and whole. Hallelujah. Amen. When we see a miracle like Sister Lana. Amen. One day sick, didn't feel good. Same way all the way through. Yet there's something empowered her and moved her out of her seat. And around the building she ran, declaring her victory. Amen. What happened? She goes back to the doctor the next day. It's gone. When we see miracles of salvation. Amen. Stand up, Brother Vic. Amen. Stand up right there. Amen. The miracle of salvation. A man adrift and lost for years and years and years. But one moment in his presence changed him forever. Amen. Stand up, Brother Philip. A man that was there with amnesia and forgot and was lost. Looking at an old tower, and God has spoke through Brother Timothy and said, what you have seen in the natural, you will see in the supernatural when Adriana was raised up from a brain concussion. Amen. A little girl who couldn't see, and God raised her up, and God said, what you've seen done in the natural, you're going to see it in the supernatural. And that week, amen, God moved on that man, amen, with a pile of prayer cloths underneath his mattresses, prayed on by every preacher as her family was praying and believing. Amen. Sister Mandy was about ready to give up. She was right on the verge to give in. Aren't you glad you didn't give up? Amen. What about you? Some of you were on the verge of giving up. Hallelujah. But what happened? God, rich in mercy, came by your way and changed your life. Happened to you, angel. Made a real angel out of you. Hallelujah. What one moment in his presence. And we see things like this begin to happen. It ought to anoint our faith. If God can reach out and find a lost boy like Philip, he can find your son, your daughter. He can find your husband, your wife. He can find your situation, because this God is a God who can reach further down than any of us can look up. In other words, he can reach further down than even what I can look up and see, because many of people I gave up on that God didn't. He said when Moses began to see what God was doing, it anointed his faith to go to work. And what ought it do to us? We need a repentance. I'm quoting now. We need a revival. I'm saying myself. Okay, your brother Branham would put himself there. Shouldn't you? Yes. Amen. I'm saying myself, I need a shaking. I need something. I said I was speaking to myself this morning about myself. I need awakening up. And when I see, think of the great evidence and everything so perfectly laid out and anointed Moses' faith. He said, what ought it do to us to see what God has done in our generation? Amen. Hallelujah. Well, Brother Tim, I'll tell you, there's no hope for this kind of revival you're expecting is because it's a word revival. You know, it's the word only now. You just said it, Brother Tim. There's only one remedy to regain his favor, and that's back to the word. Well, I'd like to share with you this one from Broken Cisterns. Now, not I'm trying to support ignorance. I'm trying to tell you the difference. Education can never bring life. It takes the Spirit of God to bring life, and life must not come out of just the intellectual revival. It's got to come out of the Bible, word revival. And that word is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So is Jesus Christ the same yesterday? That's Hebrews 13:8. And when it falls today and quickens, notice it's got life in it. It's not a dead theology. You get the same results you did in Acts 2. So a word revival quickens. Amen. And it falls and it quickens and you get the same results you did in Acts 2. That's what a word revival does. So when we look at some of this stuff called the word revival and we don't see Acts 2, we see no quickening power. It ain't the word. It comes from a polished up soothsayer who polished up the message to fit his own agenda. And the message, look, he said, if obeying this word, taking this range finder, in other words, he was talking about bringing it into focus. He looked out with a pair of binoculars and rangefinder there to, you know, and he looked out and instead of seeing one antelope, he was seeing three. And he said, I had to bring it into focus. And when it focused down to one. That's what happened with our Tunis brothers. They got the message and got to study and look and they got out of focus. And they forgot the focus that Brother Branham said, you're supposed to be seeing one. And he said, and bring it down to place till I can see the same thing those apostles saw. Uh-oh. If I bring it into focus, amen, I'm going to see the same thing those apostles saw. Right. Amen. The same gospel they preached and produce the same results because it did for them. It'll strike the target every time, no matter what the church has said and the people claims to be. He said, that's what I want to look at, that word to see it. It's exactly in focus to see the same vision they saw and to do the same job it did for them. It'll heal the sick. Yeah. It'll raise the dead. It'll cast out devils. It'll bring forth a glorious church who is willing to seal their testimony with their own blood if it comes necessary to do that. That's what happens when a word revival comes. Amen. God in simplicity. Brother Branham said, when man gets so educated and smart till he tries to put his own interpretation. Well, like they say, the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Oh, that was for another day. But if they don't, well, it wasn't for another day. But I tell you, it didn't come like they did on the day of Pentecost. We receive the Holy Ghost when we believe and stuff like that. You see, there are those who absolutely have went to seed on the quotes that this is not the day of Pentecost or the repeat or the return. We got something different. The seven seals have been opened. Amen. What was Brother Branham saying? He said, this is not the return of Pentecost. The word that came on the day of Pentecost won't work for today. You're not going to get an upper room. You're not going to be with 120. Come on. And the Holy Ghost, you wait on it for 14 days or how many it was. You see, that's not the word for today. That has already been released. We don't have to wait on the Holy Ghost. You can receive it right now, today, in your seat, down at the altar, in your bedroom, in your car. Philip's brother was driving down the street, and he made a goof in the traffic somehow, and he let out some expletives. Another boy, away from God, just like Philip, let out a bunch of expletives, drove on a little bit down the road and began to think, I shouldn't do that. That shouldn't be what happens. And the Holy Spirit started dealing with his heart and changed him right there in that car. One moment, a sinner. The next moment, because of being in his presence, a child of God. Hallelujah. Amen. You don't have to wait 100, or 40 days, or 15 days, or 2 weeks, or 10 days, or whatever it was in the upper room. Right now, you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you. And you might have just done something awful. You might be living in just awful sin. But in just one moment of turning to God and repenting, God can change your life. But people live in a glare in the midst of darkness. And a glare is not the real light. They're mirages. And we've got as many message mirages where they've claimed to see things that ain't there. All of these glares. Brother Branham was talking to a priest who he had a conversation with. And he was telling him, you're the mess. We're the first church and this and that. And it's what the church said. And he said to the priest, this Catholic priest, if you're all the original church and you went after the doctrine of these men that said at Nicaea, why is it you haven't got the power they had back there in the beginning then? Why don't you do the things they did, which Jesus said? Are you with me? These people were claiming to have the true doctrine. We got the doctrine of the Trinity. We got the doctrine of the priesthood. We got the doctrine, of celibacy. And we got this doctrine of Virgin Mary. And we're the original church. And we've got the original doctrine. We are the church. And Brother Branham said, if you got the true doctrine, then why don't you have the power they had? Oh, we got the Perusia, we got the thunders, we got this and we got that. Well, then why don't you have the power that they had back there? If it's true doctrine, where are the results? No, I'm not talking to a Roman Catholic. I'm just talking to more Catholics. Oh, we're more people, said we're a different age. And that's what they'll tell you. This is not the day of Pentecost. But yet Malachi 4 was to turn us back to the faith of Pentecost. The original word, word by word. Come on. That's what Malachi 4 does. He said, we got more people now. And we live in a different age. But he said, the word doesn't change. These signs shall follow them to all the ages. Heaven and earth pass away, but my word shall never. And he said, the priest said, but you're talking about a Bible. And he said, yes, the word which is Christ, that's right. So I've got all your writings, facts of faith and so forth. If those men who wrote the Bible walked side by side with Jesus, and you say they were They were Catholic and they wrote the Bible. Don't you think they know more about the will of God and the commands of God than this modern bunch today? He said, notice if it's the church, then when they obeyed what God said originally, and it's the word of God, look at the miracles and signs and so forth they had, and you don't have them at all today. It's an evidence that God is not with you. Let that ring around the world just a moment. Because I ain't preaching to Catholic Church. I'm preaching to message people. Let it ring around the world. Let it ring in this church. You see, if we don't have them, it's evidence God isn't with us. Well, you don't understand, Brother Tim. You're without understanding. You see, you're Pentecostal and you're thinking there's just nothing more promised. We have seen the last sign of the Son of Man, and it's the last sign. Well, let me just read you a few quotes. Because if you're pointing back something 50 years ago, then you're looking in a rearview mirror. If you think that was your last sign, I'm saying you're looking in a rearview mirror. We passed that sign now 55 years or more. And go wake Jesus, Brother Branham said, the Bible said just before the antediluvian destruction, Jesus said, so shall it, will it be in the coming of the Son of Man as it was in the days of Noah. There will be giants in the earth. There were giant, great statured men. And today, there's intellectual giants. Come on. He brings it right over. He said, today they're giants, but they're intellectual giants. There's men who are great men, great powerful men. They know the Greek just like they know the Hebrew. Everything makes them set it together so intellectual. But where is that revival? Where is that God that burns on the heart of the human being? Not how intellectual it is. It takes simplicity to bring the power of God. And as I was with Moses, this is a 60 sermon, but it's wonderful. Oh, how the church ought to look this morning to find the Spirit working amongst the people. If you want a church home where the Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, the Holy Spirit will move among the people. That's the Spirit that God is raising up in the last day to take the people over into the other land, into the full promise of all the blessings of God, and to the full commission that he gave are the promise. The promises to you and your children, as Israel sought that promised land, knowing it was somewhere because they had been somebody there. So is the church. We know there's a land somewhere. There's a power somewhere because there were others over there. We know there's a land beyond the river where we're headed toward this morning, trying to go to that promised land. Amen. So you see, Joshua, he knew that land was there. He went first and he come back as a witness. Amen. And that's the only way that you can know that the land is really there, is you go over and taste the fruits and bring it back with a changed life. Somebody with me? God called ministers ought not to be stuffed with theology, but to have visited the land where they're going, bringing back the evidence of the divine love and the power of Jesus Christ to make known to their congregation that there's a land beyond the river. Amen. But Brother Tim, we're astronauts. You know, we're not in the plane age. We're just not flying around here low like the Pentecostals did. Or we're not in the horse and buggy age, and we're not in just the car age. We're in the astronaut age. All right. So he said, we have moved out of the airplane age. We got more power now. The astronaut age has come in. We have come into a spiritual age of astronaut. See, going above. It's the same Spirit, only more power. Amen. Amen. Come on. It was the same Spirit with Wesley than that was with Luther. Come on. But it was just more power. Amen. It was the same Spirit that was with Wesley in Pentecost, but it was just more power. It's the same Holy Ghost in the Azusa movement that's here now.
That's right.
Just more power. Only lifted higher can go higher, see more, believe more, be more like Christ. Not the automobile, not the horse and buggy, not the airplane, but the astronaut. He speaks on above each one. It's called the Eagle Age. How many knows you're an Eagle Age? Amen. God calls prophets Eagle Age. We realize over in the Bible in Malachi 4, we're promised the last day. He likens his prophets to eagles. He calls himself the eagle. He is a great eagle, and he's able to achieve himself a bride. He's going to, in this last days, to be able to get that bride, that ministry that's so exactly like man and his wife becomes one. And when Jehovah gets his people like him, then he lives in his people, and they are one. And it fulfills the scripture exactly what he said in St. John 14, 12. He that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also. And it's to fulfill what Jesus said would take place as it was in the days of Sodom. So shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man. Now is the astronaut age. The astronaut sees things. The horse rider, the automobile, the airplanes, either sees. He goes higher. The airplane is down here bouncing around in the clouds, having blowouts and hit downs and everything. But he goes beyond the clouds of creeds and denominations, moves to heaven, plumb away from everything. The astronaut age, we're living in the astronaut age, just as sure as God has testified by the natural happenings there. He's testifying. If we've achieved an astronaut, God has achieved what he promised to achieve in the last days, according to Malachi 4, only that he has to get somebody in his hand who can cut loose from the airplanes and automobiles, what more, not look back to what it was, but more power to lift him higher, lift him into the presence of God, lift him up where all things are possible. So if you're an astronaut, then you're in that age that it lifts you up where all things are possible. Amen. In the countdown message, Brother Branham says, there is that the hour is coming. The hour will come when we'll have to have rapture power. Not only to heal the body, but to change it in a moment, a twinkling of an eye. Christ will be so real into their bodies till he can change it. By his great death, what he purchased. And today, that token I spoke of last night, hold it before them and walk into this astronaut. And he's in prayer. Granted, Father, were visions. Oh, in the astronaut, were vision, powers, world beyond, known. And oh God, where all the great mysteries is unfolded in these seven seals, is made known to man. So it's not just doctrine. There's a power that comes with it. It's not just a mechanics, but there's a dynamics that goes with it. Amen. So now we come down here. So you say, but it's the age of the Son of Man. We've seen the last sign. The last thing that the church is going to see is Christ manifested in his power, in fullness, in his church, just before the fire falls. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are that last sign. Hallelujah. Are you with me? And he said the church is ready. She's sealed in to ready to come. There will be a big outpouring of the Spirit. Yes, sir. To grab that church and take her into the skies. Because, see, the church, the word, the bride in Christ's ministry is in his bride, which is his body, the supernatural spiritual body of his on the earth. His spirit is in there living his life right out until him and the church becomes one in the wedding. Till they become one. Amen. Again, in What Shall We Do With Jesus, he said, God's little flock that believes the word, the mechanics is ready too. We've had 50 years of teaching. It's ready for the dynamics to set it afire with the Holy Ghost. Fear not, little flock. It's your Father's good will to give you the kingdom. The Holy Ghost will strike a little church that has come out from the world. Women that wears long hair, Nazarite, to prove they're separated from the world. Hallelujah. Oh, he says, is your life worthy of the gospel? In the day and hour, well, there ain't no more coming in. You know, I have been to churches. I have stood and preached in churches where the pastor told me, where people come to me, actually, have you seen anybody saved lately? I said, yeah. Really? I mean, I don't mean in the church, you know, people raise. I mean out in the world and they come in. Yeah. I've seen them come right out of the world and saved. Huh. I wondered why it was a huh like that when an elder preacher would tell me that. Until I sat down with the pastor and said, you know, God told me and showed me that mercy was over in 2000. And there ain't going to be no more saved. I thought, when did God die and leave you in charge? Amen. For you to make such a foolish conjecture like that. Now that's been 20 years ago. And look at the opportunities that's been wasted. Because people didn't even have faith to even invite their neighbor. To invite their schoolmate or anybody else to church. Because there was no hope of salvation in that church. I tell you, it's time to get out of that rotten church. Ichabod is written over the door. You blasphemed away the Holy Spirit. I hate to say that, because good people get trapped in places like that. Just like in Baptist and Methodist and Presbyterian, good people get trapped in that. God's going to send another shaking. Brother Branham said that in this, he was saying in 1963 after the seals, he said he bit three times he sent out. They did not listen to the feast. He went and come again and said, go compel those people to come in. The table has got to be set. The table is ready and there's still room. And he said the last call was to go out in the highways and the byways. Hallelujah. In the highways and byways where there's drug addicts, prostitutes, harlots, whoremongers, filthiness. And God put a tug on their heart because they're a predestinated seed and bring them in. And we've got to have an atmosphere here when God brings them here that they can find Christ. Not an attitude of us four no more in the room. You know, it's already closed and it's already over and it's already finished up and there's no more room. There's still room. And I want to tell you, if you're lost right now today in this church or around the world, there's still room for you. Hallelujah. I hear a little sister writing me, Sarah, saying, I was a prodigal. I was in sin. The last thing my daddy wanted before he died was to see me saved. And now, Brother Tripp, I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm saved. I didn't build this building for COVID. I built this building so the prodigals could come home. I didn't build it for social distancing. I built it so that God could come down in our midst and the Holy Ghost move throughout the place and sinners weep their way to Calvary. I'm giving you the word, there's still room. The table is ready, but there's still room. And the last call, and listen what he says. He said, maybe in the next few months, or something, or year, or whatever it is, God is going to send another shaking across the country. For there's somebody still out there somewhere. Amen. I just caught sight of a man right there, put his handkerchief to his face and weeping right there. Because one day in our dedication service, a man who had wandered and had been up and down and in and out for years and years and years and years, but he heard a message of how God would meet a man and on a log and change his life forever. And right there on that log, on that pew, right up there in that mezzanine, God met him and changed him forever. I tell you, it's time for backsliders to come home, for the cold and the indifferent to get a fire within their bosom and become the revival. It's time for the church to get ready for a celebration. Hallelujah. Not like act like the older brother. We don't want them. They've strayed. They've been this. They've been up and down. And they've never supported. And they wasn't here when we needed them. And this, but oh no, bring the fatty calf. Hallelujah. Oh, you older brothers, so well, why do they get the fatty calf? I've struggled, and I've been here. It's always been available to you, but you didn't make yourself. You didn't avail yourself of it. Every day, come on, you who have never strayed, every day you can have a celebration. We'll kill a fatty calf. Hallelujah. Every service is a service where the fatty calf can be killed. And dancing clothes be put on and rejoicing. This is a God rich in mercy. God is going to send another shaking across the country, for there's still somebody out there somewhere that's a predestinated seed that the light has to fall on somewhere, somewhere in the world. The nation itself is gone. Amen. Somebody water this horse. Where is that? Amen. I got another load to pull. Hallelujah. And the message, the token. I'm looking for a time of a break forth of the Spirit of God in these last days that we're living in now, for another surge of the Holy Spirit into the church for rapture and faith just before it comes. And everything is sitting straight and ordered for that. And I believe we're at a time that the word should have preeminence. And I believe it's time we ought to lay down our creeds and our thoughts and come back to the word. Hello, message believer, today. Lay down your creeds and your thoughts and the way you think it ought to be. Come on, come back to the word. Give that word preeminence. Hallelujah. Get the Holy Spirit preeminence where he can move in the service. Hallelujah. Where he can reveal himself. Perfect faith, Brother Branham said, I'm trying to get the church into a place where we can really see apostolic times among us. Moving among us. That's what we all hunger. I wonder if you're in step with the prophet. Amen. And it's just laying right at the door. We see it. Hallelujah. Amen. I pointed out this morning, we see it, but we want to see more of it. We want it to such flow that it'll be a help to us and flow out to others. And three kinds of believers, Brother Branham said, that's the reason. I do believe when the bride is called out and elected and said in the book of life, there will come a sound from heaven that it takes such a baptism of the Holy Spirit into that bride that it take her from the earth in a rapture in grace. He said, God promised it. Now listen, I don't care how many science, how many astronauts they signed up and everything else and how many million miles they can see. I don't care nothing about that. There is a heaven. And there is a literal Jesus Christ there that will come in a body form to receive his church to himself. No matter how old that story seems, it's still the truth. Amen. God said so. That's what believers believe. Hallelujah. Amen. Again, he would preach an invisible union. Just for weeks before he would be taken. Some of you that really believe this to be the truth, that we're entering another age. We're entering the rapture age. You know, the church can't go in its condition. It can't get any better. It must get worse. How many knows that? It's got to get worse, and it can't go like this. It's got to be something, and it's moving right on now, friend. It's on. The move is on for the bride. That is the truth. That's thus saith the Lord. One of the last times this prophet would say, thus saith the Lord. He said, the move is on for the bride. That's the truth. That's thus saith the Lord. Now, I don't care what you're seeing around you. The move is on. Amen. But oh, no, don't think it's going to be a worldwide sweeping revival. word that everybody's going to come, and hey, you know, it's going to shake up the White House, and America will come back to God. Nations will bow down. It won't happen that way. Listen to your prophet and see not air with the shuck. And one of his, in 1965, Sarah tried to bring the promise of the supernatural by hand-picked Hagar. And that's what we've tried to do. We've tried this doctrine and that doctrine, and by our own hand-picked Hagar, make the word happen. So has the church trying to bring a revival. Our evangelists across the countries today, a revival in our time. A revival in our time. All you Methodists, Baptists, Pentecostals, all get together. How can you have a revival of fresh manna on an old dead vulture? How can you have it, a revival in our time? Listen, the revival will be so small, they'll never know it ever happened. The revival will be so small, the world will never know it ever happened. We're not going to shake and get in the newspaper. We're not going to be out here, you know, on CNN, God forbid. Oh, man, you'd have to be liberal to do that. And you'd have to be Catholic to get on Fox News. Because they're the last thing. Can you imagine the whore is the only thing that's got virtues anymore? And that is the status of, oh, maybe I shouldn't get into politics, but that's the status of the movement, the conservative movement today. Catholics. Their voices, Sean Hannity, Rush Limbaugh, all of these people, you know, crying out against abortion, against these other things, and Roman Catholics. Amen. You know, what are they doing? They're trying to tell the harlots, you're worse than we are. You see, the Pentecostal says there's going to be a great thing happen. It's happening, and they don't know it. See, that's it for the word. The carcass is that the eagles will be gathered just as sure as the world. That's what it said. What is the carcass? The word. He is the word. The carcass, Christ. Christ in you, the same yesterday, today, and forever. How true it is. Sarah, trying to get all the promises fulfilled. Do you see, in a great, like the church today, a revival in our time. What? By a perverted promise? How are you going to do it when God never blessed our organization? God never did use an organization. When a message went forth, they organized and it died right there. He goes on and talks about it, how it died. And he said, but now he has moved out of the Lutheran to Methodist and to Methodist and the Pentecostal. Now moved out of the Pentecostal into the seed. Because it has to be the seed. You can't beat nature. There is nothing else there that will happen but the seed. So the seed, somebody get with me. The seed will produce itself. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The same pillar of fire, showing the same sign, the same power, the same God, the same miracles, the same thing. Vindicated the word and the Bible just exactly. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So the seed will manifest itself in power. I hadn't hardly got anywhere where I want to go this morning. Let me bring it down to a few things. And God's only provided place of worship, one of his last sermons in Shreveport, just before God takes him. He recounts some dreams and things that ones have had about seeing a horse rider and him riding the trail once more. Oh, yeah. Of course, we got people that want to grab that and run with it, you know. So we got this guy down in Trinidad. He's a great horse rider riding from the West Indies and riding back east to America, and he's got the revival now. Blasphemy. And he said, I'm getting old. He was only 56. That's young, ain't it? Amen. And he said, I'm getting old, and I thought, will there be another revival? I'll see another time, and just remember, from the west will come a white horse rider. We'll ride this trail again. That's right, we're ready. It's a promise. Yeah. Brother Branham really thought his ministry would go for another ride. He died only 8 weeks after this. And it's obvious by now that he won't. For he said the only time he will preach is as a mortal. And when he returns with the saints, he will be immortal. Amen. I realize some will get offended at this, but you know, let me just say it while we're dealing with things. The return ministry bunch is conjectured and surmised at what's going to happen and have dried up on the vine and are dead, dead, dead. And the poor things can't repent, so they keep on doggedly insisting their same old nonsense. And they don't have a single quote where Brother Brandon says, when I rise again, I'm going to have a ministry. I'll preach to the Jews. I'll do this or I'll do that. Not one quote. Just foolish conjecturing and speculation. And they've made our enemies laugh us to scorn. But I want to give it real loud and clear. This message still lives on. The messenger may be in the grave, but this message still lives on. And the bride, according to Revelation 10:8, is the one who prophesies again to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. So is there possibility of revival? The world falling apart, Brother Branham said, it seems like a drying out of the churches. Can't hardly find a church anymore that's alive with the Word and the Spirit of God and great things taking place like it was not long ago. And here's where we're at. When we come down to the next one, I'm going to deal with two different subjects that Brother Branham dealt with. Two thoughts that he interwove back and forth in his ministry after the seals were opened. One thought was contained in be not afraid, testimony on the sea, go awake Jesus. And others that dealt were the disciples were between revivals and were testifying of the past and yet had gone off without Jesus. And it describes where we're at today in so many places across the world. We went off without Jesus. And we talk about the glories of the past. And the second thought that Brother Branham had, which I'll probably take next week, was of Samson, who cried, once more, Lord. And Brother Branham preached a sermon on Samson as the present state of the church, a deceived church by the world, and warned his own church of being blinded and defeated and scarred and scared of the new birth. But I want to give you a promise. We're not leaving out of here in defeat. We're not leaving out of here dragging and a bunch of hope-sos and barely making it in. Amen. No, sir. Amen. We will leave out of here as an invincible army. And I want to tell you today, you're not a bunch of cowards. You are that invincible army that God has called, who can recognize the true spirit in the framework of the Christian church and discern it. And a people who know their God, that Satan will be powerless before them. And I'm speaking to a bride around the world, not just here in this building, but around the world, who's that kind of people. a people who says, I want God more than anything. I don't want to be doty Laodicean. I don't want to be a backslidden bud. I don't want to be carried away with the things of this world. I want to be sold out and consecrated and dedicated and my life given to Him. I want to be 100%. Hallelujah. Young people who know their God, who want to be 100%. Middle age, young men, young women, married couples, old people, who says, I want to be that revival. Amen. I want that revival in my life. I need a shaking. I need a stirring up. I need a repenting. I need a coming back. I need a changing of my attitude. I want to come back and be a real church. Who is that group? Who is that people? Who, after Samson was shaved, new locks started coming back in? Who is that people? Who is that people? You can reach back there and say, it's growing again. I feel it's coming where I can tie seven locks again. Same power of God in every church age. And there's power returning. And I feel it begin to surge up in me. And I'm getting ready for that time, for my final time, where I can get vengeance on that devil who has destroyed faith in the hearts of the people. Well, I can get vengeance for my blinded eyes that the church has had. Where I can get vengeance. I want to say, who is that people Brother Branham saw when he went down through that spooky forest that was groaning out there in the wind? Oh, days of miracles are past. An old burnover forest. Who is that people? That he looked and he saw underneath them. They looked down on him. But underneath them, there's some little trees growing up. And where these are groaning, these are rejoicing. And they are waving in the wind of the Holy Spirit and saying, yes, he's alive. Yes, he's resurrected. Yes, he's in our midst. Yes, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the Holy Spirit blows through the church. And they don't groan. Oh, how long will this be today? How long will this be? And how I'm so wore out. Oh, they don't groan. They say, hallelujah. Pour it out, Lord. Send the Holy Ghost. Move through this building. Move through this church. Move through these individuals. Hallelujah. People that are alive, that can sway in the moving of the Holy Ghost. Will you stand together with me? Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Will you worship him just a moment? Come on. Thank you, Jesus. He brought me out. He brought me out. Oh, I thank God he brought me out. Just look out yonder where I could have been. But oh, praise God, he brought me in. Aren't you glad for that today? Amen. Let the Holy Spirit just move in your life right now, in your heart, and just say, Lord, change me in your presence. Change me in your presence, Lord. Let me have that consecration, that walk. Shake me down. Get all the world out. I see you moving. Oh, I see the COVID virus going around. I know the Holy Spirit's got to be moving somewhere. Amen. I see sickness and death and this and that and the dying. I know that the Holy Spirit's got to be somewhere moving in the lives of hearts. Let it move on me. Amen. Let it move on me. If he said the move is on for the bride, that's thus saith the Lord. then why don't you say, Lord, let that move be in me this morning. Move me, Lord, in your presence. Move me, Lord. Oh, God, feel me again. Feel me again. Revive us again. Is there hope of revival? No. Pentecost, you've seen your revival. Methodist, Baptist, you've seen your revival. I mean, you're past it. America, you're past your revival. But you as an individual, you can have an old-fashioned Pentecostal revival anytime. Right now. Amen. You can have the freedom of the Spirit like you've never known, the joy like you've never had. Move out in the Spirit into the astronaut age where all things are possible to them that believe. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just keep worshiping Him. Amen. Come on, keep praising Him just a moment. Hallelujah. It ain't just in the singing of the songs, and we start singing the songs right there. You begin to call out on God. I need that revival in my heart. I want to get ready for it, Lord. I want you to move. I need a shaking down. I need a coming to reality of what you're doing in this age. I want to experience it, Lord, in my life. Let the winds of the Holy Spirit move in my heart, Lord. Move in my life. I need a refreshing from the presence of God. Oh God, move through your people today. Move around the world, Lord. Let there be an awakening in the hearts. Amen. But let it be a drive on the inside of a heart. Amen. Oh, like it was the other day when Brother Ron was preaching and he got a reality. I must get to Jesus. I must get to Jesus. Some would drive 17 hours to go to Brother Randall's meeting, die in a terrible condition to go get to Jesus. And he said, I must get to Jesus. And he drove for 17 hours. Come in there, and we had the Holy Spirit move time after time after time until it so energized him. He said, I've had an energy like I've never known. Things have begun to happen, and going to the doctors and they're saying cancers are dying. Amen. May the cancers that are holding back the church, may they realize they are dying. May the church realize I'm getting free. I'm laying aside every weight and every sin that so easily beset me. I'm coming to a new consecration in Christ. Let him breathe on me. Let the Holy Spirit just come, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Let's sing that song. He's all I need. He's all I need. And just worship him just a moment. He's all I need. Is that D? You put it C. He's all I need. He's all I need. I will worship him now. I will worship him. I will worship him. In spirit and in truth. I How many would say, let me walk
close to thee?
Sing it with me now.
Oh, just a closer walk with thee.
Let's invite him to come walk with him.
Oh, grand
Jesus
is my plea.
Sometimes nobody else can do it.
None but thee, oh dear Lord. None but thee.
Will you raise your hand to just worship him right now? And you'll say,
just a closer walk with thee.
Oh yes,
right.
Life is over.
And
I trust it to be a rapture for you. Resurrection.
Come and then the rapture.
God, it's going to come that time.
It will be
no more. Let me just feel that sweet come over me. Away and Jesus' blood can save, make the vilest sinner free. He's still here to set free today. He's still here to deliver. He's still God making one more call. Amen. Sometimes you think he made the last call and he's got more mercy than you did. And he calls again. Come, you sinners lost and lonely. Jesus' blood and make you free. For he saved the worst among you when he saved a wretch like me. Amen. You remember how it was. You felt like you was the
one. Lost and lonely, Jesus
loved
can make you free.
Oh, don't you believe that? Yes, sir, I believe it.
For he saved the worst among you.
You remember where you are.
When he saved.
But he saved the wretch.
Like
he's killing the Savior business today.
And I know.
Oh, yes, I know.
Jesus' blood can make the vilest sinner clean.
And I know.
Yes, I know. Jesus' blood can make
the vilest
sinner clean. Into the faith.
Right now. Maybe somebody needs to step out of their seat. Say, I'm ready to surrender my life. I'm ready to make that, have that change. Amen. Maybe some of you, you repent and you were baptized, but you know you need the Holy Ghost. Won't you invite him into your life this morning? Say, right now, today. Amen.
And I know. Yes, I know.
There you go.
Jesus' blood can make the vilest sinner clean.
Come on now. Some of you sisters gather around this one right here. Amen. Here's a brother coming right now. Right over here on this side, brother. Amen. Brother Aaron right there. Amen. Pray with this one. Some of you brothers, come gather around this one. Forget your social distance this morning. Let's see the Holy Spirit move. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm scared of the virus. I'm more scared of the death angel coming to the land that's destroying souls. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes.
The path of
thank you, Jesus. Glory.
And
hallelujah. Make that full surrender. Hallelujah.
Every day.
Glory to God.
Oh,
amen.
I know.
Hallelujah.
Yes, I know. Jesus' blood can make the vilest sinner clean. And I yes, I know. Oh, Jesus' blood can make the vilest sinner clean. Oh, I know. And I know.
I know. Yes, I know.
Yes, I know.
Oh, yes, I know.
Jesus' blood can make
that's right.
The vilest
makes
sinner,
the vilest sinner clean.
And I know. Yes, I know. Jesus' blood can make the vilest sinner clean. He will keep,
oh, keep me through the ages.
Me through the ages.
Amen. Roll through all these
roll throughout.
Just one more.
seen.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God.
Nowhere hinder.
Come on, let's just call on the name of the Lord.
And I know.
Yes, I know.
Yes, I know.
Yes, I know. Yes, I know.
Jesus' blood can make the vows clean. And I know. Yes, I know. Jesus' blood can make the vows clean. Sinner, please. And I know, yes, I know, Jesus' blood can make the violent sinner clean. And I know, yes, I know, Jesus' blood can make.
And with each line and phrase.
Forget we have the tithes and offering that there at the back. Amen. Just give us unto the Lord. Also this Saturday we're going to tentatively plan a work day for this building over here to try to get it completed, pushed on to completion. It's not very far away. So if you can kind of put that on your schedule in front of you. Amen. We could use a few hands, I'm sure, to do some things. So God bless you today. Amen. Further announcements about that as we go along this week. Amen. God bless you. Dismissed. Deacons come.